In business and in almost everything else, time is a precious commodity. I know that as I get older. You want to save as much time as possible. We're going to show you some things that can save seconds or minutes in a day. You add that up over a week and a month and you save a lot of time. These aren't necessarily keyboard shortcuts. Some of them are concepts. Some of the things you may have to practice a few times. But we want to show you these Office 1 minute time savers. And the first one is one of my favorites. I'm a big fan of believing that your email and your work are two separate things. Now, I know some jobs it's not, but one of the things that I've told my staff when I used to manage in a different position was to turn off all those notifications that you have email. They look like this usually, depending upon which version of Office you have. They pop up. It could be a message from a coworker. It could be some spam. It could be something from a technical group. They interrupt you. And even if it's minor, your mind, your eyes wander to it, and you think about it for a while, and sometimes you may click on it. There are so many interruptions at work that sometimes if you just get 15 to 20 minutes of bliss, you can get some of that important work done much, much more quickly and probably better. So I'm going to show you how to turn those off. If you go down to your system tray, which is the very bottom right-hand corner of your computer, and there's a little triangle there, you click on that, and you get these little icons. You want to look for the Outlook icon. I'm on Outlook 2013, so it's this blue icon. And right-click. And right here is the Show New Mail Desktop Alert. Mine is turned off, as you can see it. So if you have a check mark there, just uncheck it, and you won't get those little pop-ups or toast or whatever you want to call them on your computer anymore. There's a couple different ways you can also do this and even turn off more things. I'm going to open up Outlook. And yeah, any version of the last couple of versions of Outlook, it will be the same thing. You want to go up to the File menu and click Options. And there's a ton of options here. Under Mail, though, click that, and you'll see this Message Arrival. It plays a sound. You can briefly change the mouse pointer. You can show the envelope in the icon bar. If you notice, the icon bar down there has a little envelope every time a piece of mail shows up. I turn that all off. I want to do email on my term, which is, you know, every 20, 30 minutes I'll probably check email. But instead of having it constantly in front of me, I want to get my work done. When I was a manager, I said, hey, look, if I really need to get you, I can IM you, or I can even get off my seat, go walk the 30 feet to your office and find you and talk to you. So I think turning off email, if you can do it in your job, is great. We can show you in the Q&A how you can set a rule. So if you have important email from your manager or somebody else, that will pop up. We can show you that in the Q&A if you're on the live call. I have the link for it in the blog if you need to look at that. Let's look at our next one here. Our next one deals with PowerPoint. And one of the best things to do when you start a PowerPoint is not open PowerPoint. Let me show you here. If I'm going to switch over here to PowerPoint, I'm going to go to the File menu, and let's say I need to start a new one. Okay, I press New. Oh my gosh. Well, at least I don't have to start with a blank presentation. Let's see here. This template called Berlin, that looks pretty good. Ooh, I'll change a color. That looks nice. I'll open it up here, and I'll create a PowerPoint. And, well, I don't like that font. Let's change the font. So right away, I've opened up PowerPoint, and suddenly I've become a designer. I'm looking at colors. I'm looking at font sizes and things like that. I'm not thinking about what the PowerPoint is about. Now, if you're just putting together two or three slides, this way is great. But if you're doing a big presentation, the suggestion and the slide that I was talking about came from Gar Reynolds, who wrote a book called Presentation Zen, terrific book about better presenting. His thing is that you should be working on analog time to start off when you are working with a PowerPoint. If you get the video, I'm just holding up a notebook here. This is an actual notebook that I've used for big PowerPoint talks that I've given. And the first thing I do is I go outside with a pen or a pencil and write in a notebook of just ideas I have that might be something that I would want in this PowerPoint. And then I do it again and I start fleshing it out. A lot of people use Post-it notes. And just like you would see, maybe if you've seen, you know, behind the scenes of how they do TV shows or movies, they put everything up on index cards and move them around on a wall to get the correct order they want. So you can put the concepts you want on your note cards and put them up there. Or you can just also do it in OneNote. you can just start outlining in Word or in OneNote and get the outline of what you want to do. You don't have to do it on paper. You can do it right here. But get the points that you want to get across to communicate in the presentation before you open up PowerPoint. That's another time saver that I think it makes, again, you think about the content, not necessarily the design right away. We're going to do a quick thing about Windows 8. We did a poll, and about a quarter of the people are on Windows 8, and it's just the easy shortcut keys. Windows 7, and I guess this one also works for Windows 7, that snap feature is really great. You can move things to the left or right, so you can have two screens open, but a lot of times you pull and you're trying to move everything. You can use the Windows key and the left key to move to the left, or the Windows key to the right to move it to the right. And if you need to go full screen, you use the Windows key and the up arrow to go full screen. So that's just the quick ones, quick ways to work on that. It also works on Windows 8 if you have multiple things open. Like if I have the weather and I want to snap that to the left, it's Windows left. And then I can put something else in the right hand of the screen, let's say a recipe, because the weather and recipes are what I do all day. You can have both things up there, and you can snap them very quickly using the arrow keys. Left, right, up for full screen, and then down would close the screens. So you don't have to drag them, which a lot of people end up doing. One other thing about the start screen for Windows 8, a lot of people, it's a big change. If you're looking for anything, just start typing it. So if I want to open up Excel, I just start typing Excel. It appears in the right-hand side of the screen in the search box. And the top thing you do with those letters is at the top. So I can just start typing something like publisher, and I just hit enter, and publisher will open. Because if you notice, publisher was the first thing listed on there. So if anytime you're looking for a document, maybe you shouldn't be looking for the icons as much as you could be looking, just go ahead and start typing what you're looking for when you're working with Windows 8. Okay. Next one is multiple email signatures. If you have different jobs, different areas, different products that you're working with, you send email to different groups, the email signature one is a great thing to have to help promote what you're looking for. I'll show you the email signature that I work with. I'm opening up a new mail, and in the ribbon is the signature. The email that I is defaulted is this one here, which has my information, a link to office.com, and a link to this webinar series. Now, I may be sending this to Bruce, who knows everything about the webinar series, or I may be sending it to someone who might be interested, who I've never contacted before. It's just always there. And you can hot link those signatures. You can also use multiple ones. So if I wanted to, one thing I do is I used to do a series called Office Casual. If I want someone to be interested in that, I have another signature. It's just like this one. I go to the signature, pull the casual one, and that second link is added for Office Casual. You can do them really simply. I have one that's just Doug. I have a little fun sometimes. I have just the fax, ma'am, which is just my phone number, even a courier font. So if you're dealing with multiple things, you can have multiple signatures at your fingertips. They're pretty easy to set up. You just go to this signatures at the bottom here, and we also have instructions in the blog of how to set up multiple signatures. You can even have fun. I have one called the Hancock. You know, I'm feeling all big of myself and all that. You can do that. So that's multiple email signatures. The next thing we want to talk about is the quick access toolbar. This is a really great time saver. It works on all programs, Word, Excel, PowerPoint, OneNote. It's at the upper left-hand corner. You notice there's some buttons there. Those are always there when I'm on a screen for a new message. So if you go to Word, buttons will stay at the top no matter what you're doing in Word. So if there's a favorite command you have, for example, if I wanted to take this text message, if I wanted to make this message and just make it a text, you know, make it instead of in HTML, make it very plain. Let me do this. Let me grab a signature that has a lot of different fonts and stuff. This one. And I want to strip all that stuff out because I'm sending it to someone who's just looking at text email. I know that. What I would usually do is go to Format Text and then click Plain Text. So it's two steps. But what I have, and I don't think it has a, looks like it doesn't have a keyboard shortcut. If I don't remember keyboard shortcuts that well. So what I can do, though, is up here at the top, I've added the command plain text. So I just click that, and automatically my email turns to plain text. So any command that you use, you click this little arrow to the right of that quick access toolbar, and this opens up this huge, this opens up a small screen of things you can add. So if you wanted to add any of these commands quickly, you could. But add, if you click more commands, you get every single command that's in this program. Even some that aren't in the ribbon, a lot that aren't in the ribbon. There's hundreds, literally. You can add those, pull them over to the right-hand side of your screen, and they will be there. Here's another one I use for Outlook from time to time. Again, getting back to this whole concept of I want email on my time. If I'm in Outlook, people can get me. They can get me. I send the email, and I'll see it. I don't want to do that. So when I'm here in Outlook, there is a button on the send and receive button that's called work offline. There it is. What I do is I keep it in the quick access toolbar. So anytime I want to turn off my email, I just click that button. Outlook stays open so I can compose emails. I do a lot of this on Monday mornings. I do a lot of prep work for the webinar series. I can write emails. I can do anything. I can read my emails, but no new emails will come in while I work offline. So I just check that, and then when I want to get email again, I just check it right back on. So that's using the quick access toolbar. One other thing when dealing, next one we're going to talk about is converting tables to text. A lot of people do this in Excel. You can also do it in Word and even Outlook. So if someone sends you a, this is a very simple table for sure. But if you're dealing with anything complex, let's say I wanted to use some information from this table. I didn't want to cut and paste a table though into the email. I simply left click. And that gives me, if you notice up in the ribbon, you get what is called, oh, here, let me pop out the message here. There we go. So I've popped out the message here. I have a table, and when I click on the table, look what happens to the ribbon. As soon as you click on the table, table tools appear. You have to click the table to get table tools. That's what we call a contextual tab. Works for pictures. We'll show you that in just a second. There's several things you can do with design, but with layout, you can convert all that information to text. And then you can tell them, do you want it in paragraph marks? Do you want it in tabs, commas? If you have a huge table, though, you can quickly do this. Again, this works in Word and Outlook. And there it converts the information so I can easily grab it without being formatted into a table. So converting table to text works in Excel, works in Word, also works in Outlook. A couple more here really quick. Let's talk about pictures. So what I have here is an email that has a crisp picture and a blurry picture. A lot of times we have pictures in email, and it's this is a terrible picture of Sarah. By the way, I don't know who Sarah is. She's fictitious. The guy on the left, it's an old picture. I had more hair. The picture on the right is blurry, the one on the left. I'm trying to get these pictures to look this similar. A lot of times what we might do is look for another picture or go out on the web and try to find a picture. I do this a lot when someone sends me a logo and it's kind of a bad-looking logo. Well, we can work with this picture in Word, in Excel, and in Outlook. I click on the picture, I get picture tools. What I want to do is make these pictures look somewhat similar. So I can go over to the right-hand side and pick crop. And then I get these little black handles, and I can make this approximately the same size as the Doug picture. That looks about right. Crop that. Then on the left-hand side, you can do some corrections. This started with Outlook 2010. You can hit corrections, so I'm going to make her a little more sharp and soften my picture a little bit. Just try to get these two pictures looking right. A lot of things, times that I do to try, you know, she's very washed out, I have a very strong background, is you can change the color. The reason I'm doing this, and let's just pick kind of a common color on both, is I'm trying to make the pictures not be so, oh, why is she fuzzy? Why isn't there a good picture of this? If you make them more abstract, I think people just see them as pictures. They may say, oh, Doug, why is Doug using orange? Maybe that's our company color or something like that. But then they get on with the messaging of that. Too often that particular thing that's wrong with a picture is really going to it's not going to upset people. It's going to distract people from your message. So you can kind of change things and make them similar. In fact, what I would probably do here is make these both black and white, which you can do under color very quickly also. There's a black and white. In fact, as I mouse over it, you can see what it looks like behind the image, even before I click it. The other one that I've used from time to time is the color tool, which is which is artistic effects. So you can put a kind of a background or a shading on it. So again, it takes out some of the details that makes it look like a piece of art. You can do things under glass or some sketches, some that make it turn into a sketch. Again, you can take out some of the, if it's a bad picture, you kind of make it look a little different, and then the bad picture won't look as good, and you don't have to worry about. But again, I've lost minutes and minutes trying to find a good picture of something sometimes instead of just changing the picture, which I can do right in Outlook. The last thing I want to show is, again, dealing back to my favorite theme here, which is how email can sometimes make life tough. If I want to respond, let's say I got this email here and I want to respond to it. I could respond to everybody on there if I wanted to, right? Reply all. If I wanted to talk to someone, I guess I could start an IM with somebody. But there's a little button here, and it may be in Outlook 2010. I didn't check that before the webinar. But in Outlook 2013, I can IM everybody right away. You can go ahead and do that with your emails, and then it pops up there. So that's just another time saver. Again, if you're on the live call, we'd love to know yours, so we'll take a look at those. I've put the information for all of these up at our blog post for this webinar, aka.ms/save123. You'll find all the information of the time savers I just talked about, and we'll get the video up in a couple days. Also, check out aka.ms/offweb for more news about the webinar series. Leave comments about what you would like to see and learn about our upcoming special events. But for today's webinar team, next week we'll be talking about with Rick Altman about PowerPoint. But for today's webinar team, thank you for joining today's Office 15-Minute Webinar.